think the biggest misconception around climate change is that we'll be right. That it's not going to affect us too much. We'll be able to cope.
I grew up next to a river. A lot of my childhood was spent down in the estuary, fishing.
Well, I was one of those kids who spent most of her childhood going around catching lizards and putting bugs into jars and
throwing mud around, exploring.
I wanted to do something with wildlife, and they said, go to uni, get a degree. Basically, from semester one, I just loved it.
When I was a schoolboy, I met Sir Edmund Hillary. I'd always been fascinated by his crossing of Antarctica. 15 or so years later, there I was leading a trip across Antarctica.
I first lectured on the issue of climate change probably in 1994.
Studying climate variability and climate change was an inherent part of being a glaciologist.
Along the lines, I met the ecology lecturer, so her research really sucked me in. And that was all on climate change.
Climate change scientists are the weirdest scientists in the world. You know, we're the ones that wake up every morning and hope that we're wrong. And I wish that wasn't the case.
What motivates me and other scientists that I work with is a passion for the truth, to come to those eureka moments.
Once you get into it, you really can't get out of it because it does become a moral imperative in your life.
There is not the sense amongst wealthy people in technologically sophisticated countries that they are immediately exposed to the impacts of climate change.
Those people that are making decisions on climate change are much like me. They're in their air-conditioned offices. They're relatively well off. They're very removed from the immediate effects of climate change.
The people who are most vulnerable are in other places in the world, out of sight, out of mind. Let's withdraw from the global community.
Well, you know what? In my lifetime, it's not going to affect me. But they're not thinking about their grandkids.
If I say to somebody, temperature's going to go up another degree or two over the coming century, maybe 3 degrees, well, I'll just put the air conditioner on.
The reality is that climate change will affect every part of our lives because everything we do is governed by weather and by climate.
It affects everything. If we don't have a livable planet, we have nothing.
One of the important lessons is that climate change is very much an issue about people and the vulnerability of people.
We had several days consecutively above 40 degrees. School went back. I went back to my nice office. My daughter in high school went back to her demountable school buildings where the air conditioning didn't work. She was physically sick because of that heat.
More people die of heat in Australia than floods, fires, or anything else that's happening of an extreme nature.
For myself, for my family now, that is how climate change is impacting us, which is nothing compared to so many other communities and other places in the world.
There will be parts of Australia that will become largely uninhabitable because it will simply be either too hot or there'll be too little water or the threat of bushfires will be too great.
The Earth is not susceptible to climate change in the way humanity is. It's us humans that are not resilient.
I remember going to a conference and hearing some people from Alaska talking about how the change in climate has been to such an extent that their memories that have been passed down from generation to generation about the changes that species undergo on an annual cycle, that's not happening anymore.
The Earth is no longer a pristine system. They don't need to be scientists to understand that. It's founded in day-to-day observations.
What I think is disturbing is the questioning of the science, suggesting that it's an active debate, that scientists are divided about this issue. They simply aren't.
Most scientists are pretty conservative, and for conservative scientists to be suggesting that we need to engineer our way out of this mess, I think is a pretty striking message.
The debate about climate change as a scientific debate is over.
It's not an act of God that's led to climate change. It's our own actions that have brought us to this point.
And any well-trained scientist looking at the data will form the same conclusion.
All of these years later, we still have people arguing about we need a bit more evidence. But we've had it for a long, long time now.
You're just wanting to drum up research funding. You're being alarmist.
We know that climate change is something that has always occurred. It's no big deal. It's just another cycle. And, you know, when people have those incredibly firm beliefs, there's not much you can do to change them. If you say, okay, well, let's take a precautionary approach and present the worst possible case, well, you're an alarmist.
Those people that willfully seek to deny and suppress scientific knowledge are willingly damning my kids and unborn grandkids to a less hopeful future. That's what makes us angry.
We would be advised, not by the university, but by other bodies, that incorporating the term climate change into the title of our research project or into the summary would not necessarily be smart, because politicians don't want to hear those words. That was disconcerting.
I can't imagine a more important topic to devote one's personal life to than dealing with this problem. If we don't get this right, really nothing else matters.
I have daughters who are 23, got twins. I have from time to time been critical of them and their generation. Their comeback to me once completely silenced me. And that is, well, Dad, yours is the generation that did nothing about climate change.
For most people, the effects of climate change over the next decade or so are going to be felt by way of extremes. We may be able to deal with a couple of major extreme events, but if we had multiple extreme events occurring simultaneously or one after the other, we'd be placed in a very bad situation.
The worst case scenario is that the polar ice shelves completely collapse and we get many metres of sea level rise, unsustainable drought in our agricultural food regions.
How are we going to get our food? Where are we going to grow our food?
The current refugee crisis that we're seeing in the Middle East will be absolutely dwarfed by the climate change refugee crisis in the future, and I don't think any country in the world is adequately prepared for that.
How are we going to find solutions fast enough to be able to cope with these changes?
Are any of us really ready for the future?
We have to continue working as if saving the world is possible, because if we acknowledge that it's not possible, then it becomes impossible.
I expect Trump to announce within the next fortnight that America will be withdrawing from the Paris climate change agreements.
I just don't want to read anything in the newspaper about climate change. It pisses me off too much.
How do you revamp that message that climate change is important? I think we're oversold that message.
Do I feel like I'm doing enough? No. No. And yes, that plagues me with substantial guilt.
Sometimes it feels like one step forward, two steps back, and then some days it'll be two steps forward, one step back. But we have no option but to keep moving forward.
And it gets to a point we can't keep going down this path time and time again. We need to make changes.